We all love open source software for a lot of good reasons. It doesn't cost anything, it has community support, sometimes even industry support, but it comes with a responsibility. One of those is making sure that it's secure. And one of the videos that Sahdev brought us was about the three A's of open source security. Part of that involved reviewing your code, getting to know it. And so he's brought us a challenge.
That's true, Dan. So we will look at three examples of code. They are simple examples written in Golang, but easy to understand by any developers. The beauty of this simple code is that they represent three areas of OWASP top 10 security risk areas.
Cool. Okay, so let's take a look at our first example. And by the way, you get to play along too. Look for this symbol when I ask the question, and then you'll see this symbol while I'm thinking about it myself. And then finally, the answer will show up this symbol. So taking a look at our first one is about someone getting a password. And there's kind of the question of security and code. So the first thing that jumps out to me is when you're doing a scan, the password's going to be shown as the person's typing it. Now, I don't know if that was exactly what you were after. So that's going to put down as my first one is don't show the password. Right? But that might not be what you were after. The other thing that kind of jumped out at me besides that is when you say to save the password, and this is where I was doing some security audits myself, and they mentioned that when you have critical data, you don't want it ended up in logs, for example. And so here, I wouldn't be passing around a password that is in the clear. In fact, a smart way of doing this is you run a hash on it first, because you really don't care about what the person has stored as their password. You care, will the hash of it actually match, which is good enough for password security purposes. The other upside is that when you pass into the database, you can avoid a potential problem where someone has inserted things in that password that is trying to do a SQL injection. And that's where someone is trying to trick the program into running a SQL query that really wasn't intended. So that's the three things I think I was talking about was the run a hash, make sure that the password has the keywords or the complexity that it should have, and also the SQL injection. Those are my three answers. That is my final answer.
Well, you did good, Dan. I must say that. So this is an example of one from OWASP top 10. This is an example of cryptographical failure. Right? Mm. You never store passwords in plain text. Hashing with salting, that's what you want to do.
Right, exactly. Right?
And then second thing, as you said, with complexity, one of the thing is it's not checking, at a minimum, the length of password. Mm. Longer the password, they tend to be more safer. So,
we have a bunch of videos on that topic, as a matter of fact, so be sure to check it out.
Sure.
One other thing to think about is when you look at your password and it's being stored in a database, not just storing in the clear, it's any time is both at rest and in motion. That's kind of what I use as a rule of thumb, is you have sensitive data, you have to think about both cases. Can a DB admin see it? And can it be potentially exposed in the log? So that's kind of question one.
That's true, you got it.
Great, okay. Now we're going on to the second one, which is, mm-hmm. release wasn't quite so easy. So here we are. Now, okay, this requires just a teeny bit of explanation for Q2. And you see this permission here of 0700. For the Unix, people who are newer to Unix, let me point out what that means, is that's referring to the permissions. And it's a bit pattern where each one of these numbers represents the permissions for the owner, group, and everyone. And so, for example, this says that it's a 3-bit pattern that they have execute or traverse writes, read, and write. That's essentially what the 7 means. And I have to admit, when I first look at this, I didn't really see a problem because it's saying essentially this 700 is saying, I'm going to let the owner be able to read, write, or traverse it, which is perfectly legit. And no one else can. Another common pattern you'll see is 755, which is saying essentially the owner can do anything they like and the other people can read or traverse.
Mm-hmm.
I had to look this one up, and if you haven't hit pause already, here's your opportunity to go do that and look it up yourself. I tried to find some potential flaws here. One thing it mentioned was the UMask, capability, where you have the masking that's applied by the operating system to a newly created file. Though I don't know if that's what you were after. The other possibility is that there's a coding question here, because you're checking to see if the error that came back was nil, but it could have already existed. So that was really, one was umask, prior existing, and the other one, I give up. Can I phone a friend?
Well, no, you pretty much got it, actually.
Really?
Yeah. So the one big thing here is, you know, every time you use any function, right, like go package here, right, make dir all, or using third-party packages, right, mm-hmm. you must know, understand the function, right, before blindly using it, how it works.
Right. Right.
So make dir all, you know, it's a function that will create the directory for you with the desired permission if it's not there.
Yeah, if it already exists, it'll just leave it alone.
Exactly.
It doesn't even return an error.
Exactly. So what's missing here is, what if there's a directory which is there with 0777?
Yeah, right, right. In fact, when I was looking up through Stack Overflow, there was this big argument about a potential race condition for this too. Because as you check to see, is it come back in an error, and then I check to see it exists, in between, potentially someone could have come in and created that file. And so it turns out this is actually, for such a small problem, it's something to really look
at. It's a small, but this is one of the, like I said, this is the top, actually, one of, this is the number one problem in the top 10 risk areas. It's called broken access control.
Wow. Right. Okay. So let's go on to the last one then. Mm-hmm. And so that's question three. Okay. So I have to comment first that I'm not really happy with this as a code example, because it kind of offends from a few other ways besides security that I feel compelled to point out. For one, please don't do this where you write a sleep loop. That's kind of a bad idea overall, because that means that the process is going to continue to consume resources. It also means the process has state in it, and if it is somehow terminated, you've lost that state. A more proper way of doing this is that you should create some sort of background daemon that you register these sleep notifications, or I'm sorry, these notifications with, and hopefully that will do the result that you want. So I don't think that's what you were after, though. So what
that's
I think
true.
That, yeah, but I felt compelled to mention it. But I think what you're after is that if you're doing this sleep notification, especially if it's just for a longer period, potentially the access rights of the person you're notifying has changed in between the time. Like imagine, for example, you're getting an email notification coming from one of your systems, and they need authority to be able to do that. Well, if I withdraw that authority and I have this background process running, potentially I'm going to be notifying them, giving them information, leaking them information that they really don't have a right to do. And so in this code example, where they're in the coming out of this reminder, they should check to make sure that that user has the authenticity to do that.
So now you got you touched a couple of good points, mm-hmm. but the one of the main thing I'm looking here, from security risk areas, and which is, like I said, this is number three in the OWASP top 10, right? Input validation or data validation. So what we're doing here is, you know, we're getting the input, right? Let's say you got, 10 minutes, right?
Sure.
Now, as you said, you know, we're using sleep here just for simplicity, right?
Oh, okay.
In real life, you know, in Golang, you may be using Go routines, mm-hmm. right? A thread running, right? A daemon mm-hmm. running, right?
Sure.
And that might be running it, you know, you for as long as the app is running, right? And sending reminders or some sort of,
so you're saying, for example, someone passes in 1,000 minutes or something like that, or repetitive, that's very...
That's true. Or think about it. You want a notification every 10 minutes, for example, or every 1 hour, right? You make a little bit of a logic change here. Mm-hmm. So, you know, 1 hour for, let's say, for 30 days, right? Mm-hmm. Or 24 hour, every day, you know, for the whole month, right? What if somebody pass a negative value or zero? We're not mm-hmm. checking it. So instead of 1 hour or 10 minutes or whatever you desire, it's going to send it instantly, right? Because it's zero, you know, or negative.
Yeah, okay.
So
okay.
that will, one, it's going to be incorrect from, you know, what mm-hmm. your expectation. Second is, you know, we're logging it, right? Mm-hmm. Depending on, like you said, you know, the total numbers, you know, because there's no cap here either, it can really, you know, use all the hardware resources, like the storage. keep logging, and, you know, like instantly, right? And your expectation was every hour or every few minutes or so. But because you didn't check the input, it can crash your system eventually.
That's a good point. And in fact, I would argue that if you're looking at parameter checking, it's not a bad idea to even check it between routines. When you're passing, someone's passing your parameter, at a minimum as an assert statement, to say, these are the what I expect is reasonable parameters. If you want to, for performance reasons, you might have them optional at runtime. But certainly during unit tests, certainly during integration tests, and during your final testing, you want to have every single routine test to make sure that a state it's expecting is actually legit. And in this case, the one I got wrong, I didn't.
Yeah, it's just like it's an easy thing, but sometimes we miss it, right? So the data validation, when it's not done properly, it can create several problems, like out of bound memory, right? SQL injection is other thing where, you know, because you're not, you know, you can prevent it through the validation, right?
Well, great. That was a fun quiz. Let's go ahead and wrap that up. And I'm curious, down in the comments, I want to hear how many did you get right, and if you found anything else that I might have missed. So there it is. Thanks again, Sahdev.
Thank you, Dan.
In the comments also, be sure and leave us what you'd like to see in other Tech Talk topics. And before you leave, please don't forget to hit like and subscribe.